Well, I'm pleased to welcome everybody back for the final of Professor Harris' talks, and today the title is Renormalization, a BPHZ theorem for stochastic PDEs.
Okay, thanks. So today's lecture is going to, we'll see how it connects to yesterday's lecture in a moment, but I want to start again with stochastic PDEs, go back to stochastic PDEs as we've seen at the end of the first lecture. And so let's take an example, okay? So let's take the following example. So I call my unknown H, and so H will be a random function from, say, the one-dimensional, from the circle into the reals. And I want to solve the following PDE for H. So I take a heat equation. Then I have a nonlinearity of this type. So I have some function evaluated at H times the derivative of H squared plus another function evaluated at H plus some third function evaluated at H times a noise term. Okay, and so that noise term here, you should think of it as being a random space-time distribution, which satisfies that if I look at the covariance between two space-time points, Tx and Sy, the covariance is just given by a delta function in T and a delta function in X. Okay, so it's, and this is Gaussian. So you should think of these, as I already mentioned on the, in the first lecture, right? So you think of these guys as being independent if these, this point is different from this point, because then this will be zero. And, well, it's kind of infinite to one if the two points are the same, because then you will get delta function at the origin. So that tells you that this is not a random function, but it's actually a random distribution.
Here, H is also a distribution.
No, so here in this example, H is going to be a function, okay? So this random, okay, so this is a random distribution, so in principle you might think that the solution would be a random distribution, but it turns out that as a random distribution, this guy is sufficiently well behaved so that if I look at the baby version of this, so the baby version is when this guy is zero, this guy is zero, and this guy is one, okay? So if I just look at, say, VTV, x squared v plus xi, then this guy is a random function. Okay, so as a matter of fact, this guy, if you look at it at a fixed instant of time, it looks like a Brownian motion in x, but x is one-dimensional, okay, and the one-dimensional Brownian motion is continuous. So it's a function, it's a continuous function, but it's not very regular.
So it's a Brownian motion.
So it looks like, right, so it looks like the, exactly, so if you have a sort of a fixed time, your V sort of looks like this as a function of X, where this looks like a picture of a Brownian motion. And if you look at the behavior in time at a fixed X, then that's actually worse.
Worse,
yes. So in the sense that Brownian motion has every, remember, Brownian motion had scaling as 1.5, so at every point it was a bit like a square root singularity, and in time this guy has scaling exponent 1/4. Okay, so in time at every point in space it has sort of like 4th root like singularities everywhere.
So it jumps?
No, it doesn't jump, so it's continuous.
Oh, it's still.
But it's just that it has, it's basically held a 1/4, it's basically held a half. Well, a half minus in x and a 1/4 minus in y. Okay. So in the sense that it really isn't a half Hilda, but yeah, it's a half, there are logs, both in x and in t. Okay, and so you see that these, all the products, that, so evaluating, right, f of h is not a problem because h is a continuous function, so f of h is again a continuous function, that's fine. But the derivative of h is a problem. In particular, the square of the derivative of h is a problem here.
Bigger problem.
It's a much bigger problem. And so actually, even So of course the square here is kind of a problem. This product here is also a problem, right? Because even if I've somehow made sense of the square, then I still have the problem of having to multiply a pretty badly behaved distribution with a function which is only holder continuous, and you're not allowed to do that either. And so you have the same problem with this problem, actually. Right? So all of these products are kind of ill-defined, so it's not clear a priori what it means to solve this equation. And so the so in this particular case, the analog of the statement that I wrote down at the end of Tuesday's lecture, so one of the last slides, is the following. So now if you so you have a okay, so here you have a group P minus, which is finite dimensional, and it basically acts on the space of triples F, G, and sigma. Okay, so let me write, I don't know, say curly, I don't know, curly F to be the set of all triples F, G, sigma. Okay, so that's somehow the data that makes up the equation. So that G minus acts on that set curly F in a certain way. It acts in a way which is actually equivariant with respect to the action of diffeomorphism of R. Right? So this equation is actually a nice one because it has the property that if I look at, say, H tilde equal to G of H, and G is a diffeomorphism from R to R, then formally H tilde again solves an equation of that type, just with different F, G, and sigmas, right? And so then that gives you an action of the diffeomorphisms on R onto that space, curly F. And the claim is you can choose the action of that group to be sort of equivariant with the action of that space of diffeomorphism, so sometimes it doesn't break the chain rule.
There must be a qualitative sentence that explains why that is possible. Does that equation describe something that makes sense?
Well, okay, so the physicist's explanation is that this is just saying that you have world identities.
And what?
That you have world identities. That's just that. But then, okay, in this context, you can just check it. And so you can build these guys explicitly. You can check that it's possible to do it in such a way that this computes. And the claim is now if you take any way, you know, any sort of approximation of your white noise, which is reasonable, so for example, you make it Gaussian, with compactly supported, you know, you take some sort of compactly supported approximations of a delta function, that's fine, but it can be much more general than that. Then for any such approximation, you can find a sequence of elements, little g epsilon, in that group g minus, okay, such that if I look at the sequence of equations where I act on the right-hand side with that element, and I send epsilon to zero, you get a limit, and the limit doesn't depend on how you approximated this guy. Okay, so it's that kind of statements that you want. And actually also this action actually only changes the value of g. It changes g in a way that depends on f and sigma. Okay, so that's why it sort of acts on the triples, but it really only changes g. Okay, so that's the kind of statement that we're after. Okay, and so you see, so that's it has a similar flavor to what we've seen yesterday for the Feynman diagrams, right? So what we saw for the Feynman diagrams is that we had this kind of canonical valuation, which here would say, well, you have a canonical way of turning an element of f, for example, into a solution theory, which is simply solved at PDE, given a smooth psi. And so that's in the Feynman diagram business. It was, well, if I had smooth kernels K, then I have this canonical valuation that turns every Feynman diagram into a nice distribution. But then when I just wanted to send, to extend this to all kernels in, you know, subspace of kernels, then that didn't extend continuously. But what I was able to do is was able to find some group that acts on my space of Feynman diagrams, so that if I simultaneously act on that space in the right way, then it preserved all the nice properties of my valuation and it did extend continuously. All right, so here it's a similar business. All right, so we have that group that here acts on this type of data, and if I act on it in the right way, I can manage to extend this solution theory sort of in a continuous way to all noises in a certain class of
this
noises.
Sequence G epsilon is uniquely determined by the PDE? Or?
Right, so the sequence G epsilon is determined, well, it's basically determined by the correlation functions of the noise, right, of your approximation to white noise.
But if you choose different ways of approximating, you get different sequences?
You get different sequences. And they will, so they will always, they will typically diverge, they will be divergent sequences. They will diverge sort of in the same way, but not exactly with different prefactors. And the values of the prefactors depend on the details of how to approximate your noise. Okay. So how do you prove something like this? Right? So what you want to do is you want to have somehow, you want to reformulate this equation in a way which then somehow becomes robust under approximations of the norms. Right? And so this classical formulation, if I simply interpret this as a, you know, as a first year calculus kind of PDE, then that's not. Okay, so that's not stable under approximations of the noise. And so the idea is to make a guess, to try to make some kind of educated guess of, well, if I had solutions to these equations, what would they look like? And then only look for solutions of that kind. Okay. So here, what you can say, the first thing you can say is that, well, there's a kind of simple power counting scaling kind of argument that tells you that out of these three terms, the one that has the most singular behavior at small scales is actually the last one. Okay. And so that means that if you had a solution to this equation, at least locally, you would expect it to look more or less like the solution where you just remove that guy. And then this guy here, well, since we already guessed that the solution would be a continuous function, right? And so then locally, it's not unreasonable to just freeze the coefficients here, right? And so what does this mean? Well, it means you can make the following guess.
You guess that right here based on the elasticity of the equation to begin with?
So the way you do it is you say, well, under the parabolic scaling, this guy is self-similar with exponent minus 3/2. Then this minus 3/2 evolved under the heat equation gives a plus 1/2 for this guy. That was the 1/2 for the Brownian motion and 1/4 in time because of parabolic scaling. And then if that guy has scaling behavior, scaling exponent 1/2, its derivative would have exponent minus 1/2. Then the square will have exponent minus 1. But minus 1 is bigger than minus 3/2. Okay? And so therefore, this guy should behave worse than this one. Okay?
You assume that sigma h scale is 0.
Sorry?
You assume that the scaling of sigma h
is 0. Yeah, because it's h would, locally, it looks like a Brownian motion, and so locally it's a continuous function, so it behaves like a constant. Right, that's right. So these guys all have sort of scaling exponent zero in a way. Yeah. Okay, so that's how you do that guess. And that's the basic, so if you remember on the slides 2 days ago, I mentioned somewhere that the equation should be subcritical. And that's exactly what it means, is if you do this kind of power counting, the nonlinear terms that show up should always show up with an exponent that's higher than the one from the noise. So there's always the one with the noise which has the worst kind of power counting. So, okay. So, yeah?
Is it possible that sigma h is in some form that may raise instead of lower sigma h times the dimension of sigma h?
You can never improve regularity by just multiplying things, right? I mean, here we're really talking about actual somehow local regularity of these things. And so even if something, right, so if you have a C5 function and a C3 function, you multiply them, you don't get a C8 function, unfortunately. So the guess here, right, is that if I take, say, some space-time point, set Z0, right, so my Z's are not complex numbers, right? So my Z's are just space-time points. Okay, so I take a space-time point, Z0, and I look at the behavior of H near the point Z0. Right? So then we said, well, the behavior should be the same as the behavior of this equation, where we freeze this coefficient to just take the value of H at Z0. And now what this means is, since this equation here is linear, well, linear and homogeneous, if I multiply this guy by the psi by sigma of h at Z0, it's the same as just multiplying the solution by sigma of h times Z0, right? So it tells you that around Z0, h should behave like v times sigma of h at Z0. But then what does it mean behaving like? It doesn't mean that the value is close to that value, right? I mean, the value will be just whatever it is. It means that somehow, you know, the local little ripples that you see in the solution, they look like the corresponding little ripples that you see in sigma of h and z0 times v. All right, so what this tells you is that you would expect that h at a point z near, so for z near z0, you'd expect that h of z, you know, is reasonably well approximated by h of z0 plus sigma of h of z0 times v of z times v of z. Right, so in other words, little increments of h, so h of z times h of z0 basically looks like sigma of h of z0 times v of z minus v of z. Right, so the little ripples of h around z0 looks like the corresponding little ripples of v scaled by that coefficient, which ends up multiplying the noise. Right, so it's a kind of reasonable thing to expect. Of course, then plus higher order terms. Okay. And so then the hope is to say, well, you know, if I were able to somehow define these products for v, then maybe that gives me enough information to define them for h. Okay, and then somehow I only look at solutions in spaces of h's that look locally like that. And then hopefully I can make sense of the product for those h's, and then I have kind of a well-defined equation. Unfortunately, that doesn't work, does it? As stated, a similar idea works, but you have to go much higher in the expansion. Okay? So here, it's a bit like a, so this looks a bit like a first-order Taylor expansion, right? It looks like a first-order Taylor expansion, except that I've replaced, you know, linear functions here by this guy, which sort of plays the role of the linear functions. So it means that if I had, and this guy, remember, has So this basically behaves like z minus z naught to the 1/2, that was the scaling exponent 1/2 for the v. You know, so since that guy has exponent 0, that exponent 1/2, you know, if life is good, the next guy will have exponent 1 somehow, right? And so if you had this, well, this somehow would essentially say that h is almost c1, right? So it gives you, even though it's not, because this guy is only c 1/2, but it would give you a description of h from how up to order 1, and then the hope is that that means that it has properties similar to those of a C1 function. But it turns out that that's not good enough, because you remember this guy had scaling exponent minus 3/2, and that's what this really tells you, is that in order to be able to define that product, you need to be able to control this guy up to order strictly larger than 3/2. Okay, so it means that here, you need an error which is strictly less than somehow z minus z naught to the 3/2, which means that basically you need to go two orders further in that expansion, right? So you need to be able to guess two more orders here in the expansion. Is that sort of clear? Now, you can guess this, but the number of terms at each order starts to actually increase really, really fast. So actually, even just you can write down the next two terms, the next two orders, but that actually gives you like 12 terms already, or 13 terms, or something like this. Okay? And so you definitely don't want to actually write them out. So you want to have some kind of a you know, automated way of dealing with these things. And so for this, just like with the Feynman diagrams yesterday, so what I want to do first is I want to actually separate in these terms, if you want, combinatorial data from sort of analytic data. And so what I want to do here, I want to introduce some sort of graphical notation for terms of this type. And so what I do for this is I say, well, so that's a graphical notation. Right, so similar to what we did for the Feynman diagrams. Right? So we have a graphical notation, which is a Feynman diagram with a graph with labels and legs and stuff. And then we had a canonical way of associating to each such piece of combinatorial data a piece of analytic data, which was an actual distribution. Right? And that depended on, you know, a bunch of kernels. So here the analog will be, well, you have, again, a bunch of combinatorial objects, and then you have something like a valuation that this time doesn't turn them into a distribution, but turns them into a random distribution. And similarly to before, now this time it depends not on these kernels, it depends on the actual noise here, which shows up on the right-hand side of the equation. And as yesterday, it will be perfectly well-defined. The definition will have perfectly nice meaning when you replace that guy by something smooth. And, you know, as you let it converge to something non-smooth, then the meaning will, things will blow up. But then the idea is to actually find, like yesterday, find a group that acts on these objects in such a way that it doesn't really change their properties. And so that if you act with a suitable element on the group, you recenter this in a certain way so that it actually converges. Okay, so you do a, so it's kind of a parallel story to what we saw yesterday. And so in my graphical notation here, so now my combinatorial objects will not be arbitrary graphs like yesterday, but they will actually be trees. And sort of a little circle represents the noise, so the psi. A yellow line represents convolution with heat kernel. P, and the red line represents convolution with the x derivative of the heat kernel. So why does the heat kernel show up? It's because this guy, right, V, I can alternatively just write it as the heat kernel convolved with psi, okay? And so now, as before, I have a valuation, right? So that's probably pi, right? So pi would take that piece of combinatorial data and gives you the analytic or probabilistic data, right? So pi of that guy spits out the actual stochastic process, which is the actual knot, right? And so pi of this, right? So now you see how these combine. So you take the noise and then you add a stick to it, which means you convolve with the heat kernel, and so that gives you back that V, right? Etc. So for example, if I write pi so this here would be something like the derivative of V squared, which shows up on the right hand side. Right, etc. etc. Now the thing is, what we want to do is we want to actually, you see the terms that really show up in this kind of expansion here. It's not just the V itself that shows up, it's really the increment of V. So you actually want to somehow center these things in a certain way. So we really make these guys depend on space-time points z0, and so here it really spits out V of dot minus V of z0. And okay, so there's a natural way of centering all the higher order objects, but I'm not going to, I don't want to go into details of how you center it. There's a natural way of doing that. Okay. So now with this kind of graphical notation, right, we can rewrite our expansion in the following way. So we set our h of z. So I have now a function capital H of z. So capital H is now, instead of being a random function with values in the reals, it's a random function with values in linear combination of little pictures like this. Okay? So here, say, curly T, as yesterday, would just be the vector space generated by these pictures. Okay, and now H is a function from S1 to times R to T. So here, of course, there's time, so space and time. And having an expansion of this type, right? So what does it mean? You take this function, which just takes values into linear combination of little pictures, but then what you do is you hit it with this pi of z naught, and now that gives you a function of z, which is something like a Taylor expansion around the point z naught. Right? And then you can evaluate this at z. Okay? And so now the idea is to view, to lift this equation here to a fixed point problem in a space of functions of this type. Okay, so to do everything, to do all your calculus at the level of these kind of Taylor expansions, at the level of, if you want, like coefficients in a Taylor expansion, except that your Taylor expansion is not the classical Taylor expansion, right? So it's a generalized form of Taylor expansion. Okay, so here, in this case, so the h would just be given by little h times, so let me write, say, a yellow 1. So that corresponds to, if you want, like the empty picture, right? The empty picture is in there as well. And then I have sigma of H times this guy here. And then actually, you know, if one can go to higher order, so the next order terms look like there's a sigma sigma prime, and then there's this guy showing us, and then there's a term f times sigma square. And that was this one showing up, etc. Okay, so now, so what's the strategy? Okay, so the strategy is first find a space of functions like this that have nice properties, in the sense of similar to the normal properties of smooth functions. Okay, so find a good notion of smoothness for functions of this type. Okay. So then you have to develop a calculus for functions of this type. So you have to, in some sense, reinterpret every term that appears in the right-hand side of your equation as an operation on space of functions of this type. Right? So you have to figure out how to define all the classical operations like multiplication, taking a derivative, etc. Okay, in these spaces. So you set it up. So now, once you've done this, you obtain a fixed point problem in the space of functions of this type. And then you solve, you show that that fixed point problem has local solutions. So that fixed point problem will depend, if you want, on your valuation. Okay. So then you show that for every valuation that's somehow bound, so you put some kind of good norm on a space of valuations, you say that for every valuation in your space of valuations, you show that your fixed point problem has local solutions. And then what you want to do is you want to show that if you replace your noise by some kind of smooth approximation, that the corresponding valuation converges. But that doesn't happen, of course. Okay? And so what you do is you change, just like yesterday, you change the definition of the valuation, but you do that in such a way that it doesn't kick you out of some space of nice valuations that have all the properties that you would somehow guess. Again, a bit like yesterday, you can guess a bunch of sort of nice properties of these objects, so you want to keep all of the properties that you guess a priori intact. But it turns out that there's still enough freedom so you can actually change the definition of your valuation without breaking these properties. Okay? And then you show that when you do this, it's, you can make it convert. Yeah,
sorry. You have a loss of differentiability when you have a scale, spaces of valuation with, say, different norms, and you have a loss of differentiability? Or?
Okay, now, so in the valuation here, so just like yesterday, these objects, they naturally come with degrees. Okay, in the sense that, well, that one clearly should have degree zero, right? This guy, so the degree is sort of like related to the scaling behavior. So this guy should have degree a half. Right? And then this guy is basically two copies of that guy stacked on top of each other, so it should have degree one. This guy, well, so really here, this guy has degree minus 3/2, this convolution operation has degree 2, this guy should have degree 1, and then the total degree is simply obtained by, you know, adding the degrees of all the components that your little object is made of. Okay? So now, each of these guys has a natural notion of degree, and this recentering procedure that we had to do here is basically the natural procedure that guarantees that at least if that guy is smooth, all of these valuations, they vanish at the point that it's not, at an order given by the corresponding degree. Okay? And if the degree is negative, there's also a notion of, you know, test against test function. It has to have the right kind of the upper bound given by that negative degree. Okay? So that gives you some kind of norm on the space of valuation. But it's a, okay. So I don't want to go into details of how you define that space, but it's a relatively complicated space, because you see these guys, you have one of them for every space-time point, right? So it's not just one map that maps T into stochastic processes. It's one for every space-time point. And you want to connect them to each other. So you really also want to have a map. You have maps, sort of gamma ZZ prime, that go from T to T, that move the base point around here. Okay, so that have the property that if you compose I Z with gamma ZZ prime, that gives you I Z prime. Just like for the usual Taylor polynomial, right? So what it just said, so in the usual Taylor polynomials, you should think of, well, instead of these little pictures, you have just abstract monomials. Then the pi z is the map that turns an abstract monomial into an actual monomial, but as a function of the variables dot minus z0, right? So that's what the pi z0 does. And then what this guy does is it just takes the coefficients of a polynomial in z minus z0 and rewrites it as a polynomial in z minus z1. Or say here, or rather, it takes coefficients of a polynomial in dot minus z, and it rewrites them as coefficients of a polynomial in dot minus z prime. Right? Of course, you can always do that, and that's just a linear map depending on z and z prime, which takes the coefficients of the first guy and spits out the coefficients of the second guy. Right?
And is the role of the subcriticality the fact that there are only finite linear pictures
exactly.
that actually have to be dealt with, have to be assigned a singular
That's right.
thing.
Yeah.
So in renormal, you know, marginally renormalizable quantum field theory, your space of there would be infinitely many pictures, so to speak, that would have to be controlled all at the same time.
Yeah, so we can't deal with that situation. And actually, so in this probabilistic context, when you're in that situation, typically you don't expect to actually have a nice probabilistic object. So that's there seems to be a reason why you can't deal with it. Okay, so you put a topology somehow in this space, evaluations. And there are some nonlinear constraints on this, because you see, these little symbols, they don't really form an algebra, but there is somehow a partial product on these guys, right? I mean, this guy is basically a product of this bit, right? So there's a product given by simply gluing things together by the root. And you want to interpret this as actual multiplication, but you don't impose that. But you do impose that at the level of this recentering procedure. Okay, so you impose that gamma, say ZZ prime of a product, tau times tau bar, is equal to gamma ZZ prime of tau times gamma ZZ prime of tau bar. And somehow if you look at the actual definition of this recentering procedure, it comes out as a very natural property. Okay, so it's a property which is somehow, it's true for the canonical valuation if you want, and so it's a property that you want to keep as you deform things. Okay, so the picture is the following, right? So you take, so here is the picture of how you go about proving these things. Right, so you take your smooth approximation of your white noise. Right? So from this, you can build this canonical valuation, say pi gamma, in this way, where you essentially interpret, right? So you interpret this convolution with heat kernel, this by convolution with derivative of heat kernel, and product you really interpret it as actual product.
Okay. So, question. So, what would that? So, you have one of those graphs, one of those trees, you have two So the sigma sigma prime term. What would that graph?
This one?
No, the one above it.
This
that one.
One.
Yeah. What would that look like as a expression?
Oh, right. So you see. So you read sort of from top to bottom. So this bit, that was the V guy.
Yeah.
Right. So you take the V guy, which was heat kernel convolved with noise.
Yeah.
And then you multiply it again by the noise.
Okay.
And then you convolve the whole thing with the heat kernel.
Okay.
Right. Right. So now whenever you have a noise, if it's smooth, you can define all these operations are perfectly well defined. Right. Of course, this product becomes a problem once the thing is not smooth. But for the smooth guys, this is perfectly well defined. Right. So all these operations are perfectly well defined, and so that gives you some kind of canonical valuation here that spits out all of these pi's plus these gamma maps that somehow recenter around the different space-time points. Right. So then. From this, we build a fixed point problem in some space of functions of this type. Okay, and we look for a solution for this fixed point problem. And we prove that for every valuation satisfying some natural analytic bounds, you do have a local solution like this. Okay? And the point here, so what you gain is that first, you can do this in such a way that on the one hand, this map is actually continuous. Well, let me write it as a green arrow to show that it's a nice one. So it's continuous. And furthermore, it's continuous in the kind of topology in which you would expect this guy, the limiting guy, to live. Right? In the sense that you see this noise here, I gave it degree minus 3/2, which really means that then in the norm that I put on these things, or the topology I put on these things, it means that when you test against test function, things are allowed to blow up locally at order minus 3/2, which is exactly what happens when you actually test this white noise against the test function. Right? So it's you put somehow the right sort of topology in which the white noise lives. And it's just that some of these higher order guys, well, it's the topology which is such that if they were well defined, you would expect them to live in the corresponding space, but a priori you don't know that they're well defined. You don't know how to define them. So in a way, here you put the correct kind of topology. And this map is continuous in that topology. And so then, you know, you can do the operation of somehow just discarding. Right, so this capital H is of this form. You can simply discard all of this information. Right? That gives you the little h back, and now that's just a space-time function. And if you take here the canonical valuation, if you want, this diagram commutes in the sense that what you obtain by performing this complicated path here is the same as simply solving that equation. So at the bottom of the diagram is simply the map that takes a noise and spits out the solution to that equation. Okay, which maybe depends on the initial condition. So I should put an initial condition here. Initial condition, of course, you just take the same initial condition. But this map here is, so this map here is sort of this continuous. I mean, it's this, if you put on this space here, the kind of topology in which this psi epsilon converges to limiting noise, then that map is actually discontinuous. Okay? And so of course you cannot obtain a discontinuous map as a composition of continuous ones, so clearly it means that that guy is discontinuous. However, what you can show is that in a way this guy has some kind of continuity in probability if you add this renormalization into the picture, okay, like yesterday. Like yesterday, if you took this canonical valuation, that would be like the canonical valuation. So that was not continuous as a function of these kernel assignments. So if I took smooth kernels approximating a singular one, it wouldn't converge to a limiting distribution. But if I simultaneously renormalized it, I argued that there was a natural way of choosing the renormalization, which actually would make it converge. And so the same thing's happening here. So you have that group G minus. It's the same group as the one I mentioned half an hour ago, which acts on that space of valuations in such a way that if you choose, right, so if you act on your valuation with this element here, right, so now this group G minus acts on this space of valuations. And it acts in such a way that if you take a smooth guy, you lift it, you act on it with this particular element that was associated to it, and then you let it converge to space-time white noise, then the corresponding valuation here actually converges to a limit. Okay? In the suitable topology input on that space. And therefore, this guy converges to a limit, and therefore, this guy converges to a limit. Right? And the way you get the statement that I mentioned at the beginning is that you really have to view this, you have to view your solution map not just as a function of the initial condition and the noise, but also as a function of the right-hand side of the equation, as a function of the triple F, G, and sigma, which somehow defines your equation. Right? And same thing here. And now, if you want to make this, now you see, if you just fix an F, G, and sigma here, you lift the noise, you act on it with the G minus, you look at the solution that you get, then that solution is not just going to be the solution that you get from solving that PDE anymore. It's just going to be something obtained by some completion procedure. But then what you prove is that the same group here, the same G minus, acts down there on your space of F, G, and sigmas in such a way that this is restored, in the sense that if here, up there, you fix. Right, so up there, you fix an F, a G, and a sigma. And you plug into the solution map here, not the canonical valuation, but the valuation on which you've acted with some group element of G minus. Then you look at the solution and you discard the extra information. Then that's the same as acting. Right, so here you take some, say, so I said it only changes the G, right? So you act on that guy with the same element of G minus, that gives you a new guy which doesn't change the F and the sigma, but it only changes the G tilde, the G into some G tilde. And then the guy you obtained here is the same as what you obtain by solving that equation, but with G replaced by G tilde. Okay? Yes.
Is it the case that this renormalization group flow in the bottom left corner can be computed by calculating finitely many pictures?
Or yeah.
That's so that again has to do with the super renormalized, so that's similar to quantum.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Okay, so maybe I should, right, so the link to the, so remember the title of the lecture was the BPHZ theorem for stochastic PDEs. So in the context of quantum field theory, there's a very similar kind of story happening. Right? And so the analog of this space of right-hand sides here would be like the parameters in the Lagrangian for your theorem. The analog of this operation here would be essentially the operation of, well, okay, so the analog of this guy would be like the valuations we had yesterday, which, given a Lagrangian, spit out some kind of perturbative series, which is given by a whole collection of Feynman diagrams. Right? And then yesterday I somehow explained a little bit how this arrow works. Right? So yesterday I showed you how, well, when you have these Feynman diagrams, you associate distributions to them, and how can you renormalize them so that they actually have, they are sort of well-defined for every test function. Okay? And then what this BPHZ theorem somehow states is that you can implement this procedure by just changing the values of the coupling constants appearing in your Lagrangian. Right? And so that's somehow the analog of this picture here, which says that, you know, the operations that act on Feynman diagrams up here, they also just have an action on the coupling constants of your theory in such a way that acting on the diagrams here is equivalent to just changing the values of the coupling constants. Okay, so that's really the analogy, if you want. Right, so it's not, in terms of proofs, there's not much analogy, but also if it's a philosophical analogy, if you want. And so if there are bits and pieces in the proof that look similar, but it's not the same objects that show up. So let me just show you in the last sort of 5 or 10 minutes, I want to just give you a bit of an idea. Right, so the construction of this group G minus also is actually quite similar to yesterday. So what it does, so yesterday, remember, the operations in that group were operations that look at subdiagrams of negative degree and then contract them to points and somehow replace them by constants. And here it's exactly the same thing. You look at these little trees, you look at subtrees of negative degree, you contract them to points, and you somehow replace them by constants, and then the whole, there are somehow two aspects of the story then. There's a sort of algebraic aspect, which is to say that this operation actually leaves somehow that space invariant, so it sort of keeps all the properties of these objects. It preserves all the properties of these objects that you want to preserve. And then there's a probabilistic aspect to the story, which is to say that for every smooth and sort of with high enough moment approximation of your white noise, you can find, so again, like yesterday, so there's actually a unique element in that group. So the way you choose the element in the group is you choose it in such a way that when you take the corresponding renormalized valuation and you act on a guy of negative degree, you get something of expectation zero. Okay. So in some sense, it's a nonlinear way of recentering things by just subtracting their expectations. Okay, but you kind of subtract the expectation in a kind of nonlinear way. So you find the unique element here, which has the property that when you act on this guy, you get something which has expectation zero on the objects of negative degree. And then you have to work for 100 pages to show that this actually has the desired effect. Okay, in the sense that just by making that by recentering things, by making the expectation vanish, that then automatically gives you so much control that these guys actually converge to a limit in the topology you put on that space, okay, which is not obvious. So all of these guys, they automatically converge. Okay? And so that story is somehow hard work, but you have to, it's somewhat similar to the one I told you yesterday, and so I don't want to retell somehow the same story. So what I want to show you now a little bit is how do you actually, you know, what's a good space of functions of this type, and how do you kind of define a calculus on these spaces of functions? Right. Well, so first of all, it's a natural way. So remember, for if you have a function just from whatever RD, R, then you say it's alpha holder, right? So it's, so F is in C alpha. Well, for alpha in 0 and 1, if f of x minus f of y is just bounded by x minus y to the alpha. Okay. Now, if alpha is bigger than 1, well, of course, you can also write, you know, it becomes a bit more complicated to write down what you mean by it. So you can say if alpha is between 1 and 2, you just say that every partial derivative is in C alpha minus 1, and then you actually prove that the f itself, once you subtract it, first of all, the Taylor expansion has a bound like that with alpha. But you have to subtract like a first order Taylor expansion and not just the value, right? And, well, these guys were the ones that essentially give you the terms of the Taylor expansion. So actually, in general, a natural way of saying that you're in C alpha is not that, but is to say that if you look at f of x, so now I view f as a function from Rd to from space T like this. So I claim the natural way of defining C alpha is not to compare f of x to f of y, but you see f of y is something like the coefficients of a Taylor expansion around the point y. And so you shouldn't compare it to f of x, because it's like comparing apples and oranges. You should first take your Taylor expansion around y and transport it to x, and then you can compare it there. Right? And this is the guy that transports Taylor expansions around one point into Taylor expansions around a different point. So you should really compare these two guys. And now, that gives you an element of T, but T is a graded space. It's not graded by integers, it's sort of graded by these half integers that might be negative. But it's still kind of a graded space. And so what I should do is I should look at all the components, say the component of degree beta. So this way it just means, so this guy is a linear combination of little diagrams like this. They all have degrees. So you look at the guys of degree beta, and then you want this guy to be of order x minus y to the alpha minus beta. And so you can convince yourself that if, you know, if I define T, instead of defining T as, you know, a space of little symbols like that, if I define T as the span of, say, all the x to the k's, right, so the abstract polynomials, and then I define gamma x y of x to be just x, and then, okay, either x minus y or y minus x, whichever one it is, times, say, 1, and you extend this multiplicatively. Okay, so gamma x y of x to the k is just x minus 1 minus 1 to the power k. And then you stick this into this definition, you can convince yourself that that's completely equivalent to the usual definition of C alpha. Okay, so then this is a perfectly nice way of writing what it means to be C alpha for every positive alpha. And furthermore, this actually generalizes to anything that behaves just remotely like Taylor polynomials, right? So this definition here works perfectly fine for this guy here with values in linear combinations of these little symbols, okay? And they can even have negative degrees, so they can even represent distributions or even functions, okay? And so now let's call this space, so let's say, so that's what I call D alpha. Okay, so just by analogy with C alpha, to remind ourselves that it's a generalization. And now the claim is that these guys behave in many, many respects just like C alpha functions. In the sense that, you know, I have a product here, right? So I have a pointwise product. So that means I have a pointwise product on these functions. And so I can ask myself, you know, if I take a pointwise product of two guys like this, do I get again someone like this? Right? So it's not obvious. But here, this property here helps a lot. And the, okay, so you have to put some analytic counts on the gammas, which I don't want to go into details. But so you have theorems along the lines of, so if you take two guys, so you take h i's and say d gamma I, and you take them furthermore in such a way that you know the degree of the object of lowest degree that appears in the description of h. Right? So let me write subscript alpha I to say that the lowest degree that appears in the linear combinations for h is of degree alpha I. So in the usual Hölder functions, here there would always be a guy of degree zero, and that would be the lowest degree. Right? So for normal Hölder functions, this would be zero. But in my case, this could be negative. Right? Because for example, for the H itself, the thing of lowest degree that appeared in its description, well, was the constant. And then there was a guy of degree a half. But it means if I look at the derivative, that constant thing gets killed, the guy of degree a half becomes a guy of degree minus a half. Right? So for this guy here, this index would be minus a half and not zero. Okay? And then you can show that H1 pointwise product H2 is automatically again in some d gamma space where the gamma, well, so what is it? So for usual Hölder functions, if you multiply two Hölder functions, the regularity you get is the infimum of the two. Okay? So here what you get is the infimum between gamma 1 plus alpha 2 and gamma 2 plus alpha 1. So you might lose a bit of regularity, okay, which is kind of natural. So it tells you that here, when you multiply these two guys, if that guy, if h was of degree of regularity, if you want gamma, its derivative would be of regularity gamma minus 1. And when you square it, you would end up with regularity gamma minus 3 half, right? Because you would lose another half because of this guy. Right? And then you have a theorem which says that whenever there's a guy of positive regularity, so if you take an h in d gamma for gamma positive, then there exists a unique distribution Rh. So Rh is a distribution. So Schwarz distribution. Which has the property that indeed around every point it looks like what it should look like. You know, like this guy is somehow like the coefficients of a Taylor expansion at every point. And so now what you want is you want to find one distribution which has the property that wherever you look, it looks like the corresponding Taylor expansion. Right? So what it means is that if you take the distribution RH, you compare it to pi z h of z, right? So h of z is an element of t, pi z h of z is a distribution, right? So the pi's take elements of t spit out distributions or functions. So now I have a distribution here, I have a distribution here. I can test it against the test function. And what I do is I test against the test function, which is basically an approximate delta function centered around the same point here. So let me write like this. So it means you take an approximate delta function that has scale lambda and are centered around the point z, and then what you get here is of order lambda to the gamma. Okay, so it really means that, you know, this guy does indeed approximate this guy at order gamma. Okay? So in this sense, now every element in this D gamma space, as long as gamma is positive, does really represent a unique distribution of this theorem. Okay? And we've also seen that, well, if H is in a D gamma, in some D gamma, then this guy ends up being in D gamma minus 3/2. But it means that if you start in a D gamma with gamma bigger than 3/2, then you're still in a D gamma with positive gamma, and so this guy still represents a unique distribution. Right? And so then you've made sense of this term in the right-hand side, and you know, same story for all the other terms. Right? So you can, so in that sense, you can formulate the right-hand side as a map from some D gamma space into D gamma minus 3/2. You basically lose 3/2 worth of regularity. But then it turns out you can also formulate, so that's the tricky bit, you can formulate the operation convolution with heat kernel as a map from D gamma to D gamma plus 2. So you can show that there's some kind of Schauer estimate that tells you that solving the heat equation with the right-hand side being given by a guy in some D gamma space, that gives you a guy in a D gamma plus 2 space. So you gain 2. Right? And then you're in business. Right? Because now you have a fixed point problem where the right-hand side, well, you first lose 3/2 worth of regularity, but then you gain 2 from the heat kernel. So altogether, you gain 1/2. And then you play the usual game of, you know, turning gain of regularity into having small Lipschitz constant and obtaining a contraction and so on that you span a fixed point. Right, so that's essentially it. That's the idea of how you build this kind of map. And so in this whole construction, the point is that you never actually exploit what these pies are exactly. Right, you just assume that they're given, and that, you know, there's a bunch of analytical bounds that they're supposed to satisfy. There's a bunch of algebraic properties like this that these guys are supposed to satisfy. There's some kind of complicated space that encodes all that, but you just assume you're given one of these guys, and then whatever it is, you don't care. You're able to build such an H by solving that fixed point problem, right? And that allows you to then feed into this solution, not just the guy you obtained by the canonical valuation, but also the renormalized one, right? And then to see that actually what you end up doing is really changing the solution to the equation, but you don't see that in your fixed point problem. Right? Your fixed point problem is sort of agnostic to what the pi really does. Okay, so I think that. Stop here. But thank you very much.
Any questions?
You got a 3/2 and you only can gain 2 and we have extra room.
Yeah, there's extra room. There's actually an interesting story here with that extra room, which is right. So you would think, so you have basically 1/2 of extra room. Which kind of suggests that you could put here like a half derivative worse, okay? Actually here for some slightly different reason, things break down when you put something a quarter derivative worse.
What?
If you put something which is a quarter of a derivative worse in white noise, then actually things break down. And that's a separate reason, and that's really a probabilistic thing. It's something that doesn't show up in quantum field theory. It comes from the fact that you would, at some point, in a way, instead of just renormalizing expectations, you want to renormalize variances if you can't do that.
So you get a weak solution instead of a strong solution, something like this?
No, you just get no solution.
No solution? You get a weak solution?
So actually, okay, so we think we can, so we don't have a theorem, right? But we think, so if you take the simplest case, where f is 1, g doesn't exist, c sigma is 1, okay? And now you take some sort of alpha derivative, the white noise here, and you take alpha, well, between a quarter and a half. Okay, so in principle for alpha less than a half, with the power counting you should be fine, but I claim that it goes bad at a quarter. And so then there's some, the renormalization just ends up sort of putting a constant here. Then we think this would diverge in general. You can make it converge by actually multiplying this guy by epsilon to d whatever it is, which is 0 and a quarter, alpha minus a quarter, so. And then we think that if you take this guy and you take the limit epsilon goes to 0, it converges, but the solution is the same as if this wasn't there.
Any questions?
I presume there is no analog of anomalous dimensions, so these color indices or gradients of the space, they're
behave somehow
from the outset by power counting, but there is no dynamically generated small deviations from that.
One more question. So you created this elaborate structure. Did you study quantum field theory first, or a little bit to get some hints, or did it just come out of just analysis?
No, that really just came out of analysis. But then, of course, at some point you're going to realize that you're doing the same thing as people would be doing.
Thank you very much for a wonderful lecture.